Happy Friday, everyone, and welcome to the Black Hat edition of WatchGuard Security Week in Review, a video podcast dedicated to quickly summarizing the biggest information and network security stories each week and to sharing some practical security tips along the way. I'm your security fanboy and host, Corey Knockreiner, and this is the episode for the week starting July 29th, 2013. So this is the week of both the Black Hat and DEF CON security conferences, two conferences which I think are the biggest research conferences all year long, in my opinion. And as a result, I'm going to dedicate this episode to the three top presentations I saw this year at Black Hat. But before I dive into these three Black Hat presentations, I do want to mention other security news happened during the week despite these conferences. For time's sake, I can't really cover this, but I do want to mention two things. First of all, if you're a Bind DNS administrator, Bind has a pretty big update to fix a huge denial of service flaw, so you should go patch that. And on top of that, Snowden released some more information about alleged NSA spying, where he talked about this project called the XKeyscore program, which helps analysts at NSA data mine information that they're actually tapping on the internet. So I don't have time to go into either of these stories in detail, but be sure to check the reference section of my blog post for this video, and I may cover these stories in future episodes. Anyways, let's jump right into the top three presentations I saw this year at Black Hat, the first being titled I Can Hear You Now, which was a presentation by Tom Ritter and Doug DePerry. Now, this was a presentation that talked about the hijacked Femtocell, which I had mentioned to you in previous WatchGuard Security Week in Review episodes. Essentially, a Femtocell is a small routing device you can connect to your wired broadband connection to extend 3G wireless capability if you don't happen to have service in your area. And Tom Ritter and Doug DePerry talked about how they hijacked a Samsung Femtocell to do all kinds of man-in-the-middle attacks. While I shared this story in a previous episode, during the Black Hat presentation, these researchers shared more details on how they hijacked this particular Femtocell. So let me summarize how they did it. First of all, these Samsung Femtocell units had a HDMI console interface. Now, you did hear me right. They used HDMI, which is typically a display interface for console on these devices. So the first step to hijacking this Femtocell is actually creating this Frankenstein HDMI to USB cable that allows you to actually connect to it as a console. Once you connect to it as a console, you can actually see that it's running a pretty typical version of Linux. And once they saw that, they used many embedded Linux vulnerabilities to actually interrupt the boot of this device. And once they interrupted the boot, they were able to run some startup scripts and get full control of it. Now, once they had control of the device, they learned a lot of interesting things. First of all, this particular device loads a kernel module that ensures that all connections, any traffic it sends outside its external interface, is via an IPsec VPN connection. So they weren't immediately able to capture any traffic or do any sort of man-in-the-middle attacks because everything was encrypted. So the first thing they had to do was create a very special kernel module to basically allow them to gain access to some of this communication before it dropped down to the VPN kernel module. So it was quite an impressive and technical hijack. Anyways, once they were able to create this module, they could gather all kinds of information from any cellular device that connects to their Femtocell. And the way Femtocells work is your device, if it comes within range, it's automatically going to connect to that Femtocell if it's the strongest cellular tower in the area. There's no authentication and you have no control to stop it from connecting to the Femtocell, assuming, of course, the Femtocell is using the same carrier as your phone. Finally, the most interesting part of the research that they hadn't disclosed in their previous story was the fact that they figured out how to clone cell phones using this Femtocell. Long story short, cell phones nowadays use this special authentication encryption technology called CAVE, and it makes it harder for someone to copy the special identification numbers on your cell phone, and once they've cloned that, be able to pretend to be you using a different cell phone. It's very hard to do with normal towers that use this CAVE encryption. However, they learned that this femtocell device did not enable CAVE encryption. So if they were able to learn these special identification numbers that cell phones use for your particular phone, they could clone it onto their own phone and they can then start racking up minutes using your phone number on their phone. Now the good news is the actual Samsung device that they actually hijacked, Samsung has fixed some of the vulnerabilities that they used to hijack the device. But they alluded that there's other vulnerabilities that will let them in still. And their main advice to the industry was femtocells should go away. There's really no reason we should be extending cellular activity through these devices. Rather, they recommended that the industry needs to adopt the ability to do wired or voice over IP calls when they're connected to Wi-Fi networks. Even if at your home, your provider doesn't actually have any cellular towers, if you have a normal Wi-Fi internet connection, your phone should be able to use that to make calls. And if they did that, they wouldn't have to worry about providing femtocells. In any case, very interesting research, and if the carriers continue to provide femtocells to customers, I expect attackers to still try to leverage these sorts of flaws in the future. The second interesting presentation I saw was MacTans injecting malware on iOS devices via malicious chargers. Again, this was another story I covered a week ago, but no details were shared at that time. During this presentation, the researchers who discovered this issue actually released details how they could create a malicious charger that could silently inject malware onto your iPhone or iDevice, even if it wasn't jailbroken. So how did they do this? As you probably know, Apple has a pretty rigorous walled garden. It's very hard for Trojan authors to actually get malicious applications onto their app store because apps are signed with certificates which Apple has to provide to developers. When you submit something to get on the app store, they actually will vet your code and make sure there's nothing bad before they let it on. And they do rigorous processes like that that make it hard for people to put malicious software on Apple devices. On top of that, unless you jailbreak your device, there's no way to sideload apps. The only place you can get apps on a non-jailbroken device is the App Store. So how can a malicious charger get a malicious app on a non-jailbroken phone? Well, as it turns out, the one way you can get non-App Store apps on an iPhone is if you become an Apple developer. If you spend about $99 to gain access to Apple's SDK and develop applications, you actually get something called a provisioning profile on your phone. And you can use that provisioning profile, which is attached to the UID of your iDevice, so that you can write an application, you can sign it yourself, and then your iPhone will run that particular application because your provisioning profile has a signature that allows it. Now, of course, anyone else that doesn't have a phone that's attached to this provisioning profile cannot run that particular application. This was the weak chain that allowed these attackers to sneak malware onto Apple phones. So here's how. First of all, when you plug a charger into an iPhone, it actually gains significant access to your iPhone if you have it unlocked. It can actually pull information from your iPhone like the UDID, which is the device ID of your specific iPhone or iDevice. It can actually sync stuff to your iPhone. It can essentially do everything iTunes does. So here's the workflow. Essentially, when you plug a charger in, their malicious charger would grab the UDID of your phone. The malicious charger would also somehow need to have internet access, presumably through a wireless connection, because what it needs to do is the attacker has an Apple developer ID. He needs your UDID because he needs to go through Apple's tool to automatically add your UDID to his development profile. Once he's done that, he can use his file access to your phone, which happens with a USB plug, to actually transfer silently a provisioning profile to your phone and install it without any sort of interaction at all. So that's one of the flaws that allows this, the fact that just plugging your phone into a USB device can force it to get a provisioning profile without you knowing. So once it's given you their provisioning profile and attached your phone's UDID to their development account, they now can load any sort of application they want to via USB to your phone, and your phone will run it. And essentially, since it's not a jailbroken phone, it doesn't actually have root control over the phone, but in the presentation, they showed how they used a number of tricks that even without root access, they could do things like steal screenshots from your phone, which might include you entering passwords one character at a time, and lots of other interesting things. So really, the weakness here was the fact that bad guys can leverage these provisioning profiles of developer accounts in Apple to force malware onto phones even that weren't jailbroken. So anyways, how do you protect yourself against this? Well, the good news is iOS 7, which is due to come out soon, is going to have some pop-up dialogues that are going to warn you if you plug your phone in to a device that actually is trying to gain file access to it. So the third interesting presentation I went to was one titled "The SCADA Who Didn't Cry Wolf: Who's Really Attacking Your SCADA Systems?" by a researcher called Kyle Wilhoit. Now this is the second part of a presentation he gave at the UK Black Hat. Essentially, this is a researcher from Trend Micro that set up some SCADA honeypots. He put these honeypots on the internet to kind of research what attackers would connect to them and what they would do. Now, a lot of the information in this presentation talked about the fact that he saw over 300 attacks against these SCADA systems, many coming from Russia and China, and some of these attacks were pretty sophisticated and tried to exfiltrate data from the SCADA systems and even modify how the SCADA systems work, like adjust their temperature or stop their fan or things like that. But rather than cover these statistics in detail, I want to talk about an interesting thing this researcher decided to do in order to attribute the attackers against this honeypot. And by attribute, I mean how he identified who they really were. As you and I know, it's pretty easy to remain anonymous on the internet. You can use relay servers, proxies, VPNs, and all kinds of things, so that even though a researcher on a honeypot can see your IP address, it may not be your real IP address. So this researcher decided to do something that I think was ethically gray in order to attribute these attackers. There's an exploit framework out there that researchers are probably aware of called BEEF, the Browser Exploit Framework. And this is a framework that allows, if you control a website, for you to create JavaScript that when a browser connects to it, you can actually gain some control of the victim's browser and do things like load Metasploit shellcode, start to do things like scan his network via his internal network via his browser, and all kinds of other interesting things. In order for this research to attribute who was really attacking the system, he actually loaded some script onto his pretend SCADA web interfaces that contained the BEEF exploit. So any attacker that came to these honey nets connected to the web control system and did things would actually get injected with the BEEF framework. So long story short is he was striking back or hacking back these attackers. Now, once this researcher injected these attackers' browser with the BEEF framework, he could have theoretically gained root access and owned these attackers' machines. But he says he is very careful what he did. He only wanted to do things like see if they were using Tor anonymizers, try to find where they physically were in the world, learn a little bit about the registry keys on the system they were running, and something about the system information. So he said he is trying to limit what he is learning about them just enough to attribute maybe the location and profile of the attacker. Nonetheless, this is clearly a researcher using hacking techniques, using unauthorized computer access to get information from someone that is attacking him. And that is the definition of strike back or hack back. So what I found more interesting in this presentation, even though his SCADA research was pretty interesting, learning how many people out there really are trying to leverage SCADA flaws, I found it more interesting that he actually decided to do something which is very legal gray area. He even mentioned he wasn't sure if he'd have a job with his current employer after this because his lawyers were very against him doing this sort of thing. It really shows that some researchers are getting more aggressive with hacking back. And while I do think that this researcher's heart was probably in the right place, I really don't think this is a good thing to do. I think as a security community, we need to set an example. And as enticing it is to actually attack attackers back so we can learn about them, if we're breaking the same laws that we're trying to use to protect ourselves from these attackers, we're really not doing a good thing. So anyways, those were three of the more interesting presentations I saw this year at Black Hat, but there are actually a lot more. There was one, how to hack surveillance cameras like a Hollywood hacker, and many others. So do know over the next few days, I'll probably create a written summary of some of these presentations, which I'll post to WatchGuardSecurityCenter.com. So if you're not already following our blog, I really highly recommend you do. Besides my upcoming Black Hat posts, we consistently post all kinds of security news and alerts to WatchGuard Security Center, so please follow the blog. On top of that, you can follow me on Twitter, I'm SecAdept, and follow WatchGuard at WatchGuardTech. As always, thank you for watching, and here at WatchGuard, we're rooting for you. Thank you.